Hi, this is Remembering the Past, the show where we talk about people who've died recently who've had a profound effect on our history, our society, or our culture. We're going to start out with a brief mention of James MacGregor Burns, who died recently at the age of 95. He was a writer and political historian who specialized in biographies. He did important biographies of John and Edward Kennedy, but his most notable biography was that of Franklin Delano Roosevelt. And in 1970, he won the Pulitzer Prize and the National Book Award for his book Roosevelt, Soldier of Freedom, which was a study of Roosevelt's leadership during World War II. That was actually a continuation of an earlier book he had written on Roosevelt's early years in 1956, called Roosevelt, the Lion and the Fox. From that, his interest morphed into leadership, and he wrote books and taught courses on leadership later in his life. He came from a Republican family in Western Massachusetts, but he was a liberal Democrat, and virtually all his subjects in his writings were liberal Democrats, though he wasn't always especially complimentary of some of them. If I had to sum up his career, I'd have to sum it up with the saying, those who can't do, those who can't teach. He was a combat historian in the Pacific during World War II, and he won a Bronze Star, and after that he got a PhD from Harvard. In 1958, he actually ran for Congress in Western Massachusetts, and he didn't win. It was a heavily Republican district. So that's when he began his writing and teaching career for all intents and purposes. And along with his lecturing and his writing, he taught at Williams College for most of the second half of the 20th century. In 1993, he went on a year sabbatical to teach at the University of Maryland on leadership, and they were impressed with him there. They named a center after him. It's currently an independent nonprofit organization, the James MacGregor Burns Academy of Leadership. He was a prolific author even into his 80s. You'd see him write op-eds every once in a while. And one of his last books was a biography of George Washington, James MacGregor Burns. We're going to move on now to our feature, Elaine Stritch, who died recently at the age of 89. Elaine Stritch was one of the first ladies of American theater, a doyenne of American theater. She was a hard-living, hard-drinking woman. She's one of these people you wonder how she made it to 89, as hard as she lived. She used to go drinking with Judy Garland. She dated Marlon Brando and Ben Gazzara. If there had been a Rat Pack for women, she would have been in it and she might have led it. But she was responsible for one of the greatest numbers in Broadway history, and I was lucky enough to see it in the spring of 1971. In fact, it was around the same time that I saw Bonnie Franklin do Applause on Broadway in that show, which we talked about. But Elaine Stritch was in Company and played the hard-bitten, cynical Joanne. And at the end of the show, the 11 o'clock number, she did this song, which was sort of a play within a play itself, called The Ladies Who Lunch.
I'd like to propose a toast. Here's to the ladies who lunch. Everybody laugh. Lounging in their caftans and planning a brunch. On their own.
As I said, that's one of the famous Broadway numbers, and she had that trademark gravelly voice. Anyway, Elaine Stritch was a nice Catholic girl from Detroit. She was the daughter of a car executive, a lot of those going around at that time. I think he worked for B.F. Goodrich. She had a Chicago connection. Her uncle was Cardinal Stritch, the archbishop in Chicago in the 40s and 50s. Loyola Med School is named after him. And Elaine Stritch got her interest in show business from one of her black maids who took her downtown to the jazz clubs in Detroit, where she heard her first jazz number as a little girl.
The name of the song was I Want a Long Time Daddy Who'll Be Ready Anytime I Call. Well, I didn't know that was all about sex and all about it. It was the fact that the rhythm of it, I want a long time daddy who'll be ready anytime. And I'm looking in the mirror and singing that song. And the first thing you know, my father's there. What the hell? Wasn't very funny that morning.
Well, that started her on her way, and she made it to New York City during World War II. One of the talents there at the time was Marlon Brando, who asked her for a date when she was 17. He took her clubbing in Manhattan, and then he took her back to his place.
When you go to somebody's house, they don't put their pajamas on. They just don't. If they've invited you up for a drink, why is he putting... And I'm telling you, I was just 17, and I did not know. I couldn't have told you, but I knew it was wrong. It scared me. I put my pajamas on when I go home. I'm 17 years old, and I'm in drama school in New York City. And Marlon Brando was very anxious to see what was going on with this convent girl. He was basically like every other man in the world. He doesn't want to be turned down.
Yeah, you're not going to get those kind of stories much anymore. Anyway, after World War II, the dramatic workshop radically expanded with people coming back from World War II, and there were a lot more opportunities for actresses like Elaine Stritch. Unfortunately, one of her first opportunities was as an understudy to Ethel Merman, who was famous for never missing a performance. She made a name for herself in the 1947 musical revue Angel in the Wings, where she sang the song Civilization. This was a big hit at the time, and unfortunately I don't have her sing it. But based on her version, Danny Kaye and the Andrews Sisters made a big hit out of it the same year.
So bongo, 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 I don't want to leave the Congo, no, 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 no. Bingo, bango, bongle, I'm so happy in the jungle, I refuse to go. Don't want no bright lights, false teeth, doorbells, landlords, I make it clear.
That no matter how they coax him,
I'll stay right here.
Elaine Stritch got a couple of good parts on Broadway in the 1950s in Pale Joey and Bus Stop, but her big break was in 1961 when she got the lead in the Noel Coward play Sail Away. Here she and Noel Coward dished the dirt.
Travel, they say, improves the mind, an irritating platitude, which frankly entrenew is very far from true.
Stritch, as I suspected, began by being tiresome, but after a couple of days, she saw the light.
Opening night in London, he was giving a big party for the Swells. The guest list was mind-boggling, breathtaking. He said, and I want you to behave yourself. And I bought a new dress at Harrods that was so Katharine Hepburn that you couldn't believe it. It had a neck that was so high it was dangerous. And I didn't drink. I had ginger ale all evening long. So Noel called me the next day and he said, Elaine, and I always knew it was serious because there was no Stritchy around. Elaine, I ask you to behave yourself. I did not ask you to behave like a f***ing geography teacher.
Well, in 1970, she got the aforementioned Company, which, by the way, was a Stephen Sondheim show, big hit. Sondheim, by the way, in his autobiography later on, revealed that The Ladies Who Lunch was not only written for Stritch, but inspired by her acerbic delivery of self-assessment, as he put it. She did Company for 2 years, and then she couldn't find exactly the right theatrical vehicle, and she moved to London. She started a television show there. She did do some television in the United States. Ironically, she was supposed to be the first Trixie on The Honeymooners, and she was supposed to be a big, brassy stripper. Jackie Gleason ultimately thought better of it, and I think that was a good decision. Ultimately, a character like Elaine Stritch would have taken away from the chemistry between Norton and Crampton, probably would have taken away from the character of Alice Crampton, too. Later in her life, she did some television. Often, the roles that would have been right for her went to people like Bea Arthur and Eileen Eckert, who were sort of the same type of characters. But Elaine Stritch was always better in front of an audience as opposed to in front of a camera. It's not to say she wasn't good on television. She had a couple of Emmy Award nominations, and in fact, she did win an Emmy as Alec Baldwin's mother on 30 Rock. Besides that and her Tony nomination, she also won a Grammy nomination for Best Spoken Word for Children for a children's album she did in 2005. It was a Halloween album. You gotta believe that Elaine Stritch could scare children. She was inducted into the American Theater Hall of Fame in 1995, and it looked like her career might be over at that point, but then she came back with a great one-woman show in 2002, Elaine Stritch at Liberty.
The makeup! I hate it. I need it. The headaches, the heartaches, the backaches, the flops! Been there, done that, got all the t-shirts.
Little trivia question on Elaine Stritch. She was married once. She was married to a guy named John Bay, who was the heir to the Bay's English muffin fortune. Finally, to close on here, here's a number she did in the Stephen Sondheim show, The Follies. It became another one of her signature songs. It's called Broadway Baby.
Broadway Baby, making rounds all afternoon, and I'm eating at a greasy spoon. To save on my doll. Oh.
Finally tonight, we're going to close with Johnny Winter, who died at the age of 70. And Johnny Winter was one of the great white blues guitarists of our era. When I say white, I mean white. He was not only white-haired, but he was an albino. He was born in Mississippi. His family moved to Beaumont, Texas. He was picked on as a kid, and he admitted he couldn't do much besides play the guitar. And he grew up only a couple of miles away from a girl who was also interested in the blues, who was picked on a lot in her youth, from Port Arthur, Janis Joplin. And they actually dated for a while. Here they are jamming together in 1969 in Boston, of all places. I'd like to say it became your classical love story, but it didn't. They broke up. She relocated to the West Coast. He relocated to the East Coast via Chicago. They did both find heroin and alcohol. I mentioned Johnny Winter came through Chicago. That's where he met Mike Bloomfield, nice Jewish boy from Glencoe who got expelled from New Jersey High School. But he was a great blues guitarist at the time. He was playing with Paul Butterfield. And Mike Bloomfield turned Johnny Winter on to all the great Chicago blues musicians, including B.B. King and Muddy Waters. And Muddy Waters loved Johnny Winter, and they worked together for the rest of his life. Muddy Waters used to say that Johnny Winter was one of the few white blues guitarists who played just the right tempo. Here they are on a number together.
Yeah, I'm gone away to leave. Won't be back no more. Going back down south. Child, don't you want to go?
Yeah,
woman, I'm troubled. I'll be always mine. You know, I just can't be satisfied. I just can't keep from crying.
Johnny Winter did play at Woodstock, but his performance didn't make the film. I think that was a bad decision on his manager's part, but I'm not sure how that happened. But in any event, Columbia talent finder John Hammond signed him to a contract with an unheard-of $600,000 advance for the time to start cranking out albums. And that he did. In the early 70s, he was overshadowed by his brother Edgar Winter, who was a more versatile musician, played more instruments, but I don't think he was the virtuoso that Johnny was. I mean, he was also a great musician in his own right. It's amazing how much talent those two had. But while Johnny Winter was primarily a musician, Edgar Winter had more of a flair for the dramatic. Johnny Winter continued to perform throughout the 70s and 80s with guys like B.B. King, but ultimately the drugs and alcohol started to take their toll on him. And it's safe to say that his heyday was really in the 70s. Although Rolling Stone named him one of the 100 greatest guitarists of all time. Rolling Stone, by the way, did one of the first pieces on him in 1968 that brought him to wider attention. I have to tell you, even in the 1980s, he could still pick it. Here he is in a 1987 performance on Swedish TV with Sound the Bell. I also want to include a little of the cover he did of the licks by another guitarist, Keith Richards. Here's a little bit from Jumpin' Jack Flash. Tell you one thing, that's a long way from getting picked on back in Beaumont, Texas. You could tell from that performance alone that Johnny Winter lived a pretty hard life. Well, I'm going to close on that note. I want to thank my producer, Sid Tepps. As a closing tribute to Johnny Winter, I'm going to play a song that he covered, written by Chuck Berry. It wasn't written about Johnny Winter, but it sure could have been. A southern boy who could play a guitar like a ring and a bell. What else? Johnny B. Good.